Morning, students. In the previous class, I discussed about watering of the eye and dry eye. And today's class, I will take dichroocystitis. This is the only topic in this class. So, in the previous class, watering eye and dry eye is taken and was taken. And so what are the causes of watering eye? It is because of two causes. One is hyperlacrimation and other one is epiphora. Hyperlacrimation is increased secretion of the tears, and epiphora is due to inadequate drainage of the lacrimal passages in the normal secreted eye. So epiphora is of two types. It may be because of the lacrimal pump failure, that is physiological, or anatomically it may be due to obstruction at the different sites of the lacrimal passage. And hyperlacrimation is of three types, that is primary hyperlacrimation, reflex hyperlacrimation, and central hyperlacrimation. So, various causes of watering eye and clinically, how will you evaluate the watering eye? By ocular examination under diffuse illumination and magnification, and with the help of regurgitation test and fluorescein dye disappearance test, lacrimal syringing and Jones dye test, and dichroocystography and lacrimal scintillography. This is about watering eye and dry eye. It is maybe in the tears. In the tear film, there are three layers are there. That is like lipid layer, which is superficial layer, middle aqueous layer, and lower mucus layer. Mucus layer is secreted from the goblet cells of conjunctiva. Aqueous layer is from the lacrimal gland, and lipid layer is from the meibomian gland. So these tear, normal healthy tear secretion is regulated by hormonal regulation and neural regulation. Hormonal regulation is mainly by the androgens, and neural regulation by the neural fibers which are present adjacent to the lacrimal gland and the mucus secreting goblet cells. And this is the classification of the dry eye, which is aqueous deficient, evaporative. In the aqueous deficient, two types, Sjögren dry eye and non-Sjögren dry eye. And in evaporative causes, it is because of lid diseases like meibomian gland dysfunction, or due to extrinsic causes like vitamin A deficiency and due to contact wear, lens wear, are due to some certain drugs. So this is about dry eye. And so various pre-diagnostic tests we conduct in the patients of dry eye is tear film breakup time. Normally it is 15 to 35 seconds. If it is less than 10 seconds, it is an abnormal test. And second one is swimmer's test. We measure the wetting of the swimmer strips. If it is less than 5 mm, it is a severe dry eye. It is in between the 10 to 15 mm, it is a moderate dry eye. And if it is greater than 15 mm, it is a normal eyes. So Rose Bengal stain, it is a most sensitive test. It helps to identify the mild cases of keratoconjunctivitis based on the different patterns. The severity of the dry eye is assessed. And the grading of the dry eye is based on the dry eye workshop. It is graded into four levels. It is a level 4, it is a very severe dry eye. If it is level 1, it is a mild dry eye. This is the treatment part. So today's topic is dichroocystitis. So what is dichroocystitis? It is the inflammation of the lacrimal sac. So it is classified into two types, acquired dichroocystitis and congenital dichroocystitis. In the acquired dichroocystitis, again it is divided into three types, that is acute dichroocystitis, chronic dichroocystitis, and acute and chronic dichroocystitis. So this is a classification of the dichroocystitis. Basically, the dichroocystitis is nothing but the inflammation of the lacrimal sac. So coming to the congenital dichroocystitis, it is the inflammation of the lacrimal sac occurring in the newborn. It is also called as dichroocystitis neonatorum. The main causes of congenital dichroocystitis is, it is because of the congenital blockage of the nasolacrimal duct, or due to presence of membranous occlusions at the valve of Hoechner. Where is valve of Hoechner present? It is at the distal end of the nasolacrimal duct. It prevents the backflow of air from nose into the eyes. So if there is any membranous occlusions in the valve of Hoechner, it may lead to congenital dichroocystitis. And due to presence of epithelial debris in the nasolacrimal duct, and due to non-canalization of the nasolacrimal duct, and due to because of the bony occlusions caused to the nasolacrimal duct. So these are the different causes of congenital dichroocystitis. So what are the common bacteria which causes this congenital dichroocystitis? That is staphylococci, pneumococci, and streptococci. So, whereas clinical features we see in congenital acrocystitis epiphora, that is a watering of eye because of the lacrimal pump failure. And because of the infection, there is a mucopurulent discharge is seen. And we also observe the swelling of the sac area. If you conduct a regurgitation test, we see regurgitation of some mucopurulent secretions from the pumpae. So these are the clinical features of the congenital diacrocystitis. So what is the treatment? So first, as the child is, if the child is less than 1 year, less than 9 months, first only the treatment modality is just the massaging of the lacrimal sac area with the help of little finger. We will ask the mother to massage the lacrimal sac area like this. And we also advise the topical antibiotics. So only if it is the patient is less than 9 months, the only treatment modality is massaging over the lacrimal sac area and topical antibiotics. And if the second modality is lacrimal syringing, by doing lacrimal syringing with normal saline and the antibiotic solution, there is a chance of reducing the congenital diacrocystitis. Next one is probing. If the child age is more than 1 year, then we advise probing. This is a Bowman's probe. We pass this probe through the lower punctum into the canal liquid, and by this, if there is any obstruction, it can be reduced. So if the child age is more than 1 year, probing is advised. If the probing fails, then the other option is balloon catheter dilatation. Here, with the help of probe, we pass a balloon catheter into the canaliculi, into the lacrimal sac, and we inflate that balloon. So by that, if there is any obstruction which is causing the infection, it can be relieved. So first thing is massage. If the child age is less than 1 year, then lacrimal syringing with antibiotic solution. If the patient age is more than 1 year, we do probing. Even after repeated probing also, if it did not relieve, then the other option is with the help of probe, we pass a balloon catheter into the lacrimal sac and we inflate it so that if there is any obstruction, it will be reduced. So balloon catheter dilatation is the other option. Then if the balloon catheter dilatation also fails, the other option is intubation with the silicon tube. We pass a specialized tube called silicon tube through the canaliculi into the lacrimal sac, and we put the silicon tubes for at least 6 months, and we observe for the reduction of the congenital diacrocystitis. The intubation with silicon tube also fails. The final option is surgical option, that is the diacrocystorhinostomy. We have to wait for 4 years. 4 years, and the surgery is performed only after the age of 4 years. So with the help of this diacrocystorhinostomy, we create a bypass between the lacrimal sac and the nasal mucosa, and this helps in the proper drainage of the lacrimal gland secretions. So this is the treatment of the congenital diacrocystitis. So if the child is less than 1 year, the only option is massaging over the lacrimal sac area and lacrimal syringing. If the child is more than 1 year, lacrimal probing is done with the help of Bowman's probe. Even after repeated probing, if the congenital diacrocystitis is not relieved, then we have to go for another option called balloon catheter dilatation. So there is a specialized balloon with the help of probe. It is passed through the canaliculi and the balloon is inflated. So if there is any membranous occlusions or any obstruction, that can be relieved with the balloon catheter. Even after balloon catheter, if the patient is not relieved, then we intubate with the silicon tubes and leave the tubes for at least 6 months. So if this fails, then final option is diacrocystorhinostomy. In order to perform the diacrocystorhinostomy, the child should have more than 4 years of age. So this is about congenital diacrocystitis. The second topic is acute diacrocystitis. What is acute diacrocystitis? It is an acute suppurative inflammation in the lacrimal sac characterized by the presence of painful swelling in the lacrimal sac area. As its name suggests, it is acute in nature. We see severe inflammatory signs, that is a painful swelling is seen at the region of the lacrimal sac. So this is the acute diacrocystitis. We see a swelling at the lacrimal sac area. So what is the etiology of the acute diacrosystitis? It may be developed in two ways. First one is due to acute exacerbation of the chronic diacrosystitis, and second one is acute peridiacrosystitis. There is any infection to the surrounding structures like paranasal sinuses or surrounding bones or dental abscess or caries tooth in the upper jaw. This infection may spread to the lacrimal sac, and it may cause acute diacrosystitis. So this is the etiology. So what are the predisposing factors? It is more in age groups between 40 to 60 years, and the females are predominantly involved. And due to females are more involved because compared to the males, there is a narrow lumen of bony canal is seen in females, and the heredity also has an indirect role because of some hereditary diseases. There is a changes in the facial configuration. So because of the changes in the facial configuration, there is a those people who have a small length and width of the bony canal is seen, that leads to smaller and narrower nasal lacrimal duct. So heredity has an indirect role. And because of the poor lid hygiene and poor personal hygiene, this also acts as a source of infection for acute diacrosystitis. So these are the predisposing factors of acute diacrosystitis. So what are the causative organisms? Here also streptococci, pneumococci and staphylococci are the most common causative organisms. This acute diacrosystitis is divided into three stages. First one is stage of cellulitis, second one is stage of lacrimal abscess, and stage of fistula formation. So in the first stage, that is the stage of cellulitis, we see all the inflammatory signs. That is, we see painful swelling in the region of the lacrimal sac. The swelling is red, hot and firm and tender in nature. Tenderness is seen, and surrounding structures like lids and cheeks also will be edematous, and there is a symptom before, that is watering of eyes seen. This acute diacrosystitis is also associated with the constitutional symptoms like fever and malaise. If at this stage, if it is treated, it can be resolution is seen, but if it is untreated, self-resolution is very, very much rare in this stage of diacrosystitis. So basically, in the stage of cellulitis, we see all the inflammatory signs like swelling over the lacrimal sac area, redness, hot, firm swelling with the tenderness is seen at the lacrimal sac area. Usually, if you treat at this stage with antibiotics, it can be relieved. But if it doesn't treat it, self-resolution is very much rare in this stage. So this is about stage of cellulitis. Following this stage, if this stage is not treated, it leads to second stage called stage of lacrimal abscess. Because of the continued inflammation, there is occlusion of the canaliculi as there is inflammation, edema of the canaliculi tubes is seen. Because of the edema, the tubes get blocked, so that whatever the secretions present in the lacrimal sac get infected, and the sac is filled with the pus. So because of the collection of pus in the lacrimal sac, the lacrimal sac was distensed, and eventually these walls rupture, forming the pericystic swelling. So if this stage of cellulitis is not treated, the inflammation continues, and this inflammation leads to inflammation of the canaliculi tubes. Because of the inflammation, the edema occurs and the tubes get blocked. Whatever the secretion present in the lacrimal sac got infected and turns into purulent secretions. But this process continues. There is a rupture of the wall of the anterior wall of the lacrimal sac, and that leads to pericystic swelling. In this way, we see a large fluctuant swelling is seen, and eventually the abscess is formed. So usually the lacrimal abscess points below and outside of the sac due to the gravitation of the pus, and the presence of medial palpable ligament in the upper part of the sac. So this is the stage of lacrimal abscess. So this is the picture of the lacrimal abscess. So next stage is stage of fistula formation. So if this stage of lacrimal abscess is left untreated, this goes into stage of fistula formation. There is a, because of the lacrimal abscess, there is a discharge. There is an opening to the external skin, and that leads to formation of the external fistula below the middle palpable ligament. rarely this abscess may open into the nasal cavity and they form and leads to formation of the internal fistula. So if this abscess which is opened outside, this leads to fistula is opening through the skin. So if this is the external fistula, because it opened through the skin, if the abscess opens inside the nasal cavity, that leads to internal fistula. So this is the external fistula here. Here in this patient, after instilling the fluorescein dye, the dye is coming from the skin opening here. So this is external fistula. In this picture showing healed external fistula. So the stage of lacrimal abscess is untreated. It because of the breakage of the anterior wall of the lacrimal sac, it leads to opening through the skin, that is external fistula, or sometimes it may open inside into the nasal cavity and it forms internal fistula rarely. So these are the three stages of acute dacrocystitis, that is stage of cellulitis, stage of lacrimal abscess, and stage of fistula formation. So what are the complications of acute dacrocystitis? As there is an active infection in the lacrimal sac, this infection may spread to the conjunctiva and may cause acute conjunctivitis. And rarely, if there is any corneal aberration or epithelial defect, because of the as there is an active source of infection, this because of the epithelial breach, that this infection may spread to the cornea and finally leads to corneal ulceration. And we also see lid abscess, osteomyelitis of the lacrimal bone, and rarely arterial cellulitis and facial cellulitis, and acute ethmoid sinusitis, and very rarely we see cavernous sinus thrombosis and generalized septicemia. So these are the complications of the acute dacrocystitis. So what is the treatment? If the patient is in the stage of cellulitis, we give systemic antibiotics like ciprofloxacin or cephalosporin or tetracycline cotrimoxazole. And topical antibiotics also is given to prevent secondary infection of the conjunctiva and cornea. And in order to reduce the pain, we give systemic anti-inflammatory and analgesic drugs. And in order to relieve the pain, we ask the patient to apply hot fomentation on the lacrimal sac area where the swelling is present. So this is the treatment of the stage of cellulitis. If the patient is in the stage of lacrimal abscess, in addition to the above treatment, when the pus starts pointing onto the skin, it should be drained with a small incision. We give a small incision and the pus is gently squeezed out, and the dressing should be done with the help of betadine. So if it is in the stage of lacrimal abscess, along with the antibiotics and anti-inflammatory and analgesic drugs, we give a small incision and gently squeeze out the pus present in the lacrimal sac, and we the dressing should be done with the help of betadine. So later, depending on the condition of the lacrimal sac, either the surgical procedure called dacrocystectomy or dacrocystorhinostomy should be carried out, and so that the recurrences can be avoided. So this is the treatment of lacrimal stage of lacrimal abscess, where we give a small incision and we gently squeeze out the contents of the lacrimal sac. So if the patient is in the stage of lacrimal fistula, so after controlling of the acute infection with the systemic antibiotics, fistulectomy is performed along with the dacrocystectomy or dacrocystorhinostomy. So this is the treatment of acute dacrocystitis. This acute dacrocystitis can be given as a 4-month question. This is very important question. So basically three stages are there, that is stage of cellulitis, stage of lacrimal abscess, stage of fistula formation. Fistula formation, it may be external or internal, but external is a more common. Lacrimal abscess, if the patient is not at the stage of cellulitis because of the continuous inflammation, there is a blockage of the canalicular tube, and there is a collection of pus in the lacrimal sac. Because of the continuous collection of pus in the lacrimal sac, the walls rupture and they opens out as an external fistula or internal fistula. So coming to the chronic dacrocystitis, it is because of the presence of mild grade of inflammation in the lacrimal sac for a prolonged period, the longer period. Here also the predisposing factors, the age groups are 40 to 60 are more involved, and sex, it is more common in female because of the narrow bony canal, and races, it is more common in whites. Heredity has an indirect role because of the changing in the facial configuration. And people who have low socioeconomic groups and poor higher hygiene have high chance of getting the chronic dacrocystitis. with this chronic diverticulitis is because of the presence of cycle of stasis of teeth and mild infection for a longer duration. So what are the factors causing stasis of the teeth? It is because of the anatomical factors like narrow bony canal, partial canalization or membranous folds in the nasolacrimal duct, are due to presence of foreign bodies in the sac, are due to excessive lacrimation and presence of mild grain inflammation in the sac, and due to obstruction of the lower end of the nasolacrimum. These are the various causes of stasis. Stasis means stagnation of the tears in the lacrimal sac. Because of the presence of the stasis of tears and the prolonged mild infection in the lacrimal sac, it leads to continuous presence of mild inflammation in the lacrimal sac for a longer period of time. That leads to chronic diverticulitis. So what are the source of infection? The source of infection is from the surrounding structures like paranasal sinuses, conjunctiva, eyelids. What are the infections which nasal cavity, which what are the infections present in the nasal, in the surrounding structures of the lacrimal sac and nasal lacrimal duct will cause lack as a source of infection. Here also the causative organisms are staphylococcal, pneumococcal, streptococcal, pseudomonas and pyocyania. Here there are four stages are there. The first stage is stage of chronic enteral diverticulitis. Second one is stage of lacrimal mucosal. And third stage of chronic suppurative diverticulitis. And the final stage of chronic fibrotic sac. So in the first stage, that is stage of chronic enteral diverticulitis, we see a mild inflammation of the lacrimal sac along with the blockage of the nasal lacrimal duct. Because of the blockage of the nasal lacrimal duct, in the first stage, we see only mild inflammation of the lacrimal sac. So the only symptoms are watering and redness. So only watering and mild redness is seen. Here we see only mild inflammation of the lacrimal sac. If you do lacrimal syringing, we see a regurgitation of clear fluid from the opposite punctum. Clear fluid or serous fluid from the opposite punctum. When we do diverticulitis, we see a block in the nasal lacrimal duct. And we see because here it is only the mild inflammation is seen. The sac is of normal size and it will have healthy mucosa. With the help of diverticulitis, we can identify the exact site of block of nasal lacrimal duct, and here the mucosa of the lacrimal sac is normal because of the only mild inflammation. So this is the stage of chronic enteral diverticulitis. So this is a picture of diverticulitis. Here it is there is a block here in the second picture in the lower this part. Here there is a normal filling of the lacrimal nasal lacrimal duct. Here there is a block. In the upper picture it is a normal picture. Next stage is after stage of chronic enteral diverticulitis. The next stage is stage of lacrimal mucosal. Because of the continuous stagnation of the secretions of the lacrimal sac, there is a distension of the that leads to distension or dilatation of the lacrimal sac. And because of that, we observe a small swelling at the lacrimal sac area. Here in this picture, you can see the swelling. So here also, along with the epiphora and mild redness, here we see the other symptom we see here is swelling. The swelling is not seen in case of stage of chronic enteral diverticulitis. But here, because of the continuous chronic stagnation of the secretion, there is a distension of the lacrimal sac and we see a swelling at the lacrimal sac area. So when we if we perform the diverticulitis, we see a distended sac along with the blockage of nasal lacrimal duct. In the first stage, we see normal sac, but here we see distended sac along with the blockage of the nasal lacrimal duct. So when we perform the regurgitation test, we can observe there is a regurgitation of milky gelatinous mucus fluid here. Because of the continuous stagnation of the secretion in the lacrimal sac, which are not very much infected, so that we'll have the regurgitation will show milky and gelatinous mucus fluid only, not purulent or mucopurulent fluid. Only mucus fluid is regurgitated in this stage. So sometimes because of the continuous inflammation, the openings of the canalicula gets blocked, and we see a large fluctuant fluid, which is encysted. Whatever the swelling is present, it gets encysted. So that if you perform the regurgitation test, as it is encysted, the regurgitation test will be negative, because even after performing the regurgitation test, there is a reflux regurgitation of any secretion is not seen because of the encysted mucosa. whatever the swelling is present because of the closing of the openings of the canalicle, it got encysted. If so, the as the canalicle openings are closed, even after performing the regurgitation test, the secretions will not regurgitate back. So this is the encysted mucosal. This is the stage of lacrimal mucosal, second stage, and third stage is stage of chronic suppurative dacrocystitis. Because of the continuous presence of mild inflammation and collection of secretions in the lacrimal sac, these whatever the secretions which are got collected in the lacrimal sac get infected, and this changes the and this leads to pyogenic infection of the lacrimal sac. So that this mucoid discharge, because of the infection of the lacrimal sac, this mucoid discharge which is present in the second stage will become purulent discharge, and this leads to conversion of mucosal into pyosal. As the water of the mucus secretion which is present in the lacrimal sac is converted into purulent pyogenic, because of pyogenic infection it converts into purulent discharge, and that, so that the mucosal is converted into pyosal. Here also, when the canalicular openings are got blocks eventually, and that leads to encysted pyosal. This pyosal will convert into encysted pyosal. But here the symptoms we see is epiphora is seen and recurrent conjunctivitis, swelling along with the mild erythema. So this is about the stage of chronic suppurative dacrocystitis. Here is nothing but the stage of mucosal. The mucus discharge present in the lacrimal sac, because of the infection, it converts into purulent discharge. Mucus discharge converts into purulent discharge, and the mucosal converts into pyosal. Finally, the encysted mucosal will convert into encysted pyosal. The last stage is stage of chronic fibrotic sac. Because of the low-grade repeated infections and inflammation for a prolonged time, this leads to its ultimately results in the conversion of normal sac into small fibrotic sac due to thickening of the mucosa. Because of the continuous inflammation and infections, because of thickening of the mucosa of the sac, it become fibrotic. And here we see symptoms like epiphora and discharge is seen. When we perform dacrocystography, we see a very small sac with irregular mucosal folds. Because of the fibrosis of the sac, we see a very small sac with irregular mucosal folds. So this is about the four stages of chronic dacrocystitis. In the stage of chronic cataract dacrocystitis, we see only mild inflammation with normal sac. But in case of stage of lacrimal mucosal, we see along with the blockage of the nasal lacrimal duct, there is a distension of the lacrimal sac because of the closing of the openings of the canaliculi, and this distended lacrimal sac contains the mucus. So we call it as a mucosal. So this stage is not treated. These whatever the mucus secretions which are present in the lacrimal sac got infected, and that the mucus discharge will convert into purulent discharge. That in that stage we call it as a pyosal, and this pyosal got encysted because of the closure of the canaliculi, and that leads to encysted pyosal. Encysted pyosal and encysted mucosal, when in this stage, if the sac is encysted, if you perform the regurgitation test, the regurgitation test will be negative because of the complete closure of the sac and complete closure of the openings of the canaliculi. So regurgitation test is positive in mucosal, but it is negative in encysted mucosal. In the same way, like pyosal, it is positive in encysted pyosal, it is negative. Finally, in the stage of chronic fibrotic sac, because of the continuous low-grade inflammation and infection, the mucosa of the lacrimal sac got thickened, and this leads to fibrosis of the sac. So these are the four stages of chronic dacrocystitis. This chronic dacrocystitis also can be given as a 4-mark question. So what are the complications of the chronic dacrocystitis? Here, because of the, we see chronic conjunctivitis is also seen along with the chronic dacrocystitis. And because of the, we also see ectropion of the lower lid, and as there is a continuous discharge from the eye for a prolonged time, we see eczema of the lower lid skin. And rarely, if there is any epithelial breach of the cornea, there is a chance of hypopent corneal ulcers. And if there is any cataract surgery is performed in case of in the presence of chronic dacrocystitis, there is high chance of endophthalmitis is also seen. So So these are the complications of the chronic dacryocystitis. So coming to the treatment part, the first one is there is a conservative treatment. As it is a mild grade inflammation and infection, first we perform lacrimal syringing and we help that helps in opening of the block of the nasolacrimal duct. Then other options is balloon catheter dilatation. With the help of probe, we pass the balloon catheter and we try to inflate the balloon and we try to open the obstruction. And if these two fail, then we go for a dacryocystal rhinostomy. And if it is a then our dacryocystectomy when dacryocystal rhinostomy is the contraindicated. If there is a canalicular block, we go for a surgery called conjunctival dacryocystal rhinostomy. So this is the treatment of chronic dacryocystitis. So what is dacryocystectomy? It is a surgical procedure where the entire sac is completely entire sac is removed. So we remove complete lacrimal sac. So what happens as there is a no lacrimal sac, the patient will not have lacrimal pump mechanism. So what happens if there is no lacrimal pump mechanism? So even after removing the sac, because of the loss, as there is a complete lacrimal sac is removed, the lacrimal pump mechanism is not there, and that leads to physiological epiphora. So the patient will have continuously watering of eye. So this dacryocystectomy is not advisable to the all patients. It is only advised if there is a the only indications for the dacryocystectomy is if there is an elderly patient with shrunken and fibrosis sac. So what happens if the sac is shrunken and fibrosed? If it is fibrous, it will not have lacrimal pump action. So in that patient, this dacryocystectomy can be performed. So that is one of the indication. The second indication is if there is any lacrimal sac tumors. If there is any lacrimal sac tumors also, we can perform dacryocystectomy. And in case of presence of chronic infections and presence of chronic granulomatous inflammations of the sac, there is infection of the tuberculosis or syphilis or leprosy or mycotic infections of the sac that leads to chronic granulomatous inflammation of the sac. In such cases also, we perform dacryocystectomy. And if there is a associated atrophic rhinitis also, we perform dacryocystectomy. Basically, the dacryocystectomy is an easy procedure. We just remove the lacrimal sac. But if we remove the lacrimal sac, the lacrimal pump mechanism will completely lost. And so that watering eye is the complaint in patients who have underwent the dacryocystectomy. So this dacryocystectomy is indicated only in this conditions only. That is, elderly patients with shrunken and fibrotic sac, lacrimal sac tumors, and chronic granulomatous inflammations, and atrophic rhinitis. The preferred surgery is dacryocystal rhinostomy. So in this surgery, principle here, by the help of this surgery, we re-establish the lacrimal sac drainage by connecting the lacrimal sac to the middle meatus of the nose by making a ostium between the lacrimal sac and the nose. So what we do is we create a small bony small hole in between the lacrimal sac and the nasal mucosa. We create a small hole and we connect the lacrimal sac to the nasal mucosa. So we create a bone by removing the lacrimal bone, which is present in between the nasal mucosa and the lacrimal sac. So we create a bypass to the obstruction of the nasal lacrimal duct. So we create a bypass, and so that whatever the secretions which are present in the lacrimal sac can be directly enter into the nasal mucosa. In this way, we can create a bypass to the obstruction which is present in the nasal lacrimal duct. So basically, here we don't remove the lacrimal sac. We just create a small hole in the bone which is present between the lacrimal sac and the nasal mucosa, and we connect the lacrimal sac to the nasal mucosa. So this is about dacryocystal rhinostomy. So these indications are that these are the surgery of choice, except in cases of that four indications which are present in the which I discussed earlier, no, in the dacryocystectomy, except in that four indications. In every patient, the dacryocystal rhinostomy is the surgery of the choice. So there are four different types of DCR is seen. That is a conventional external DCR, where we enter through the external approach. In case of endonasal surgical DCR, through with the help of endoscopes, we through the nasal through nasal cavity we reach the lacrimal sac. Other one is, instead of instruments, we can use a laser to make a ostium, that is an opening. It can be entered through nasal approach or through canalicular approach. The laser, so basically we create an opening in the nasal mucosa bones, forming the lacrimal fossa and the posterior medial wall of the sac can be accomplished by two techniques. So opening of the bone can be established by two techniques. That is, first one is by cutting the tissue with the appropriate instruments, or by using the laser called holmium ad laser through endoscopic laser assisted, in cases of endoscopic laser assisted DCL. So basically, we create a bone in between the lacrimal, we create a small bony ostium or hole in between the lacrimal sac and the nasal mucosa through four approaches. First one is external approach, or through endonasal approach by using instruments, surgical instruments, or by using laser. The laser can be used through through nasal cavity or through endocanalicular approach. The laser which is used here is holmium ag laser. So with the help of this holmium ag laser, we create an opening in between the lacrimal sac and nasal mucosa, and we bypass the whatever the secretions present in the lacrimal sac into the nasal cavity. So as there is a passage of secretions through this opening, the lacrimal sac will not get distended, and that lead, so as it is not distended and there is no stagnation of secretions in lacrimal sac, they will not get infected, and this in this way it prevents the infection of the lacrimal sac. So what are the various steps in dacrocystoid rhinostomy? First I will show you a video, then I will discuss the steps. Can you able to see this video? Somebody respond. Here, this is the left side. Sorry. So this is the left-sided tonic dacrocystitis. Here there is a small, some swelling is seen in the lacrimal sac area. Can you able to see this video? Somebody respond. Okay. So this patient is having left-sided tonic dacrocystitis. So this is the punctae which are present here. This is the lacrimal gland from which the main aqueous layer of the tears, which forms the main bulk of the tear, is secreted. And this will reach the secretions will reach the punctae here. These are the canalicular, this is lacrimal sac and nasal lacrimal duct. This is a anterior lacrimal crest, anterior lacrimal crest bone. This yellow one is there, no? They are marked with yellow pencil. This is the anterior lacrimal crest, and this star is the lacrimal sac fossa, where the lacrimal sac is present. Star mark where it is present, no? This is the lacrimal sac fossa, where the lacrimal sac is present. And this is the infraorbital foramen. This part is the infraorbital foramen, and these are the nerves, infratrochlear and supratrochlear nerves. Infratrochlear nerve will innervate the lacrimal sac. So what we give is, first we, after putting the nasal packing, we have to give local anesthesia to the patient. Here he is giving local anesthesia to the patient. So these are the nerves which we infiltrate with the local anesthesia, like lignocaine or lignocaine. Infratrochlear nerve. So these are the nerves get infiltrated with local anesthesia. So we mark the skin, position of the skin incision with the marker, and the curved skin incision is given. Curved skin incision is given at the level of the anterolacrimal crest, which the incision should be within 8 mm from the middle canthus, because at the 8 mm angular vein is present. So it should be, the incision should be within 8 mm. Sometimes the tributary of the angular vein, which is which may come up to 3 mm distance from the medial canthus, but in the rarely it will come. But usually we give a skin incision at the within 8 mm from the medial canthus in order to prevent the rupture of the angular vein and to prevent the profuse bleeding from it. So basically a curved skin incision is given. After giving the skin incision, below the skin there is orbicularis muscle is seen. So orbicularis dissection is done. Orbicularis muscle dissection is done. So after dissecting the orbicularis muscle, the periosteum dissection is done. Below the orbicularis muscle, periosteum is seen. Dissection is done. Dissection of periosteum is done. Then medial canthal, medial palpebral ligament or medial canthal tendon is exposed. So this is the medial, here we have a medial canthal tendon. We have to release the medial canthal tendon. Then periosteum is dissected. And the elevated, after dissecting the periosteum, we elevate the periosteum. And by this, after doing this, the lacrimal sac get exposed. That is the lacrimal sac. This is the lacrimal sac. So separate the lacrimal sac from the underlying bone. This white part is the lacrimal sac. So we have to separate the sac from the underlying bone, and we have to start punching of the bone in order to create the hole in between the lacrimal sac and the nasal mucosa. So we have to ensure that mucosa stays intact. So after dissecting the periosteum, we have to separate the lacrimal sac from the bone, and we have to create a small hole here. This dermal PCA, we created a small hole in the bone, that is a lacrimal bone. We create a small hole so that we can create a bypass between the lacrimal sac and the nasal mucosa. So what are the extents of the bony ostium? So inferiorly till sac we have to make a bony ostium where bony NLD junction is present. Superiorly beyond the medial canthal tendon, and make ensure that no bone lies in front of the internal canalicular opening. Anteriorly till sufficient nasal mucosa is obtainable, and posteriorly till the ethmoid air source. These are the extents of the bony ostium. Ostium is nothing but the hole. Then we make a incision at the lacrimal sac. Here you see after incising, that is after incising the lacrimal sac, you can observe there is a expulsion of the purulent, mucopurulent discharge from the sac. Now you see he is incising the lacrimal sac. So here that white discharge is there now, that is a mucopurulent discharge which is coming out from the lacrimal sac. So in order to make a flaps, like two flaps you have to make, anterior flap and posterior flap, in the lacrimal sac. So he incised the, we given a vertical incision in the lacrimal sac. So immediately after giving the vertical incision, you can see there is a expulsion of mucopurulent discharge from the sac. So this is the reason for the swelling at the lacrimal sac area, because of the stagnation of the secretions in the lacrimal sac. So he created two flaps in the lacrimal sac, anterior and posterior flap. And we have to incise small part of the posterior flap, and this is the nasal mucosa. And here also in the nasal mucosa, we have to create two flaps. trimming of the clamp is done. We have to assess the clamp adequacy for suturing. So mitomycin C can be given in order to prevent future fibrosis of the sac. Mitomycin C can be given. So in order to make ensure with the whether we are in the right position, that is in the that we are in the position at the fundus of the lacrimal sac, we pass the probe through the punctae and make ensuring whether he is in the right position or not. Because the probe is passing through the lacrimal sac, he is in the right position. So probe pass it through the lacrimal sac, and he is suturing the flaps. So both the this lacrimal flaps and the mucosal flaps are sutured with the absorbable Vicryl or catgut. Then so he sutured the nasal mucosa and the nasal lacrimal sac. Nasal mucosa and the lacrimal sac. So that we created a bypass so that whatever the secretions which are present in the sac will enter directly into the nasal cavity. Then we have to close the muscle. Have to as we dissected the orbicularis muscle, that should be sutured. This is the suturing of the orbicularis muscle. And we are closing the skin, and skin is sutured, and we close the wound. So this is the procedure of external dacrocystorhinostomy. This is the external approach. If it is a endonasal, we use a endoscope, and it can be done with the instruments, or if it is a laser, we use instruments. In order to make incisions, we use laser, that is holmium laser is used. So the wound is closed. This is the dacrocystorhinostomy. So this is the procedure of dacrocystectomy. This is a video showing dacrocystectomy procedure. Dacrocystectomy is a simple procedure where we completely remove the lacrimal sac. So in the same way, the dacrocystorhinostomy. So you are able to see this video, no? Second video. Somebody respond. Okay. So in the same way, we are giving skin incision. Curved incision is given within the 8 mm from the medial canthus. Suppression of the skin and orbicularis muscle is doing. So orbicularis muscle is separated, and medial palpebral ligament is exposed. After dissecting the orbicularis muscle, you will see the this white part. This is the medial palpebral ligament. So with the help of retractors for better visualization, you can use the CADPAS retractors. Ligament is disinserted. Dissecting the periosteum, the lacrimal sac is dissected from the floor by lacrimal dissector. This is an instrument called lacrimal dissector, which used to dissect the lacrimal sac from floor. This is the this one is the lacrimal sac. This white color is creamy color. So dissection of the fundus of the lacrimal sac is done. This one. We also in order to identify the correct position of the lacrimal sac. We have to introduce the lacrimal probe through the upper punctum or lower punctum. So he is inserting the lacrimal probe. And the lacrimal probes will have to pass the, so he is pushing the lacrimal sac here so that he is in the correct position. So with the help of lacrimal probe, we can identify the correct position of the lacrimal sac. So fundus, what is fundus of the lacrimal sac? The part which is present above the common canalicular opening, the lacrimal sac part, which is present above the common canalicular opening, that we call it as a fundus. Middle part is the body, and the part which is nearer to the nasal and lacrimal duct, that is the neck. So he is dissecting the lacrimal sac, the fundal part of the lacrimal sac. He is cutting the lacrimal sac here. So it is dissected totally. The lacrimal sac is dissected totally. So we are completely removing the lacrimal sac. So the probe is passed, but the lacrimal sac is not there. From the nasal lacrimal duct up to the fundus of the lacrimal sac, this is dissected and removed. The curettage is done to the diseased tissue from bony nasal lacrimal duct by lacrimal screw. Suturing of the muscle with the help of Arclet's muscle with the brachial sutures. Then the skin is also sutured. So here we removed the sac, that we call it as a nasal dacrocystectomy. The skin is also closed. So this is about dacrocystectomy. Here, as we completely remove the lacrimal sac, the lacrimal pump mechanism will not be there in the patient, and the patient will have the symptom called epiphora, that is physiological epiphora will be present for the lifelong. So one minute. Can you able to see the slides? Can you able to see the slides now? Okay. So basically, you can hear. Am I audible to you? Okay. So In case of dacrocystectomy, as the entire sac is removed, the lacrimal pump mechanism will not be there in the patient. So the patient will have a watering of the eyes for their entire lifetime. So basically, we don't prefer dacrocystectomy except in those four special cases. That is, in case of fibrosed sac, and in case of tumors, in case of inflammations, like granulomatous inflammations, and in case of atrophic rhinitis, if we perform dacrocystectomy. But in remaining cases, the dacrocystal rhinostomy is the preferred surgical choice. And here the steps of dacrocystal rhinostomy are: first one is we give local anesthesia, the lignocaine. Then we make a skin incision, covered incision within the 8 mm from the medial canthus, in order to prevent the rupture of the angular vein. And we dissect, after giving skin incision, we dissect the orbicularis muscle, and we expose the medial palpebral ligament or medial canthal tendon. And then after releasing the medial canthal tendon, we incise and elevate the periosteum surrounding the lacrimal sac, and we separate, then the lacrimal sac is exposed, and we separate lacrimal sac from the underlying bone. After exposing the bone, we make a 15 mm into 10 mm bony ostium or hole is made by removing the entire lacrimal crust and the bones forming lacrimal fossa. So we completely remove the anterior lacrimal crust bone and along with the lacrimal fossa, and we expose the thick pinkish white nasal mucosa. So that nasal mucosa is exposed, and we prepare, and then after exposing the nasal mucosa, we prepare flaps of the sac by giving a vertical incision. We make two flaps, that is anterior flap and posterior flap. In the same way, we make nasal mucosal flaps, and these flaps are sutured. The posterior flap of the nasal mucosa is sutured with the posterior flap of the lacrimal sac. with the help of absorbable suture like vicryl or catgut, and it's followed by the anterior flaps. So we create a bypass, and then we have to close after the close the wound by suturing the muscle first, then skin. So these are this is the various steps of dacrocystorhinostomy. So this is the surgical procedure, commonly preferred surgical procedure. With this, I am concluding this today's class. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Somebody raised. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. In the lacrimal apparatus topic, 2 months question, tear film can be asked, and various tests of dacrocystitis can be asked as a 4 month question, and epiphora can be asked as a 2 month question, and you have to also know about various pre-diagnostic tests to evaluate the dry eyes, and you have to know a clinical evaluation of the watering eye. So these topics are important in an lacrimal apparatus topic. So cystic mucosal is because as there is a continuous inflammation of the lacrimal apparatus and lacrimal sac, so because of the there is a closing of the openings of the common canalicular opening gets closed because of the prolonged period there is a continuous inflammation and infection of the sac. There is a because of the edema of the canalicular openings, the common canalicular openings get blocked because as the common canalicular opening is blocked, so whatever the secretion whatever the secretions which are present in the sac will not come out even after putting some pressure over the sac area. Also these secretions will not come out, that so that we call it as a cystoid sac. So that is a cystoid mucosae. As the mucus is got infected and it converted into pyosis, then we call it as a encysted pyosis. So below 4 years, because we have to give general anesthesia to the child, and we can in most of the cases, in 90% of the cases, we can the child can be observed for at least for 1 to 2 years, because whatever the membrane occlusions which are present in the which are one of the cause for block may get opened in 90% of the cases. So up to 2 years, there is a chance of opening of the this membranous occlusions. So we can wait for at least for 2 years, and 4 years is because more than 3 years or 4 years is because of as we had to give general anesthesia, and it is not a visual significant problem. We can wait for at least for 4 years in order to prevent the complications related with the general anesthesia. Second internal exam will be conducted in the September month only, but maybe in the second or third week HOD sir will discuss with the other department HODs, and they will let you know. So I am closing the session. So from tomorrow I am going to take the refractive errors in tomorrow's class. With this, the lacrimal apparatus topic was completed. Thank you.
ఆప్థమాలజీ డిపార్ట్మెంట్ అయిపోయింది వెళ్ళాను. అన్మ్యూట్ ఇవన్నీ రోల్ నెంబర్స్ ఇవన్నీ ఉన్నాయి. ఎండ్ మీటింగ్ ఫర్ ఆల్
Yes.